Hello and welcome everyone. Welcome to a very special Disruptive Education live session by Global Education and Training Institute, GETI. The Disruptive Education Movement has been conceived with a grand vision of gathering global education leaders under one platform, brainstorm on and charter the next quantum leap in education. Today, at this very special Disruptive Education live session on Facebook and YouTube, we have with us a legend and a stalwart in education, a befitting symbol of women empowerment, Honorable Lieutenant Governor Dr. Kiran Bedi, India's most formidable woman. Born in a tennis-playing family from Amritsar in 1949, that is, I suppose, between independence and when we became a republic, so as old as India is, as a free country, to Prakash and Prem Lara Peshawaria, Dr. Kiran Bedi is second of their four daughters. While still in school, she became a junior national tennis champion, Asian tennis champion, and was ranked India's number one of her time. Dr. Kiran Bedi is the first woman in India to have joined the officer ranks of Indian Police Service in 1972. Served in it for 35 years and moved up to the rank of Director General Police in Government of India. For her policing stood for power to correct, power to prevent, and power to get things done. Served in the areas of crime prevention and detection, traffic policing, narcotics, police training, and prison management. Dr. Bedi served as police advisor to Secretary General in the Morning United Nations in the Department of Peacekeeping Operations in New York. Recipient of the Ramon Magsaysay Award, also called Asia's Nobel Prize Award, for bringing about a positive relationship between police and the people. And we know how necessary that is today. We can see what's going on world over, and this is a relationship that she has helped build over the years. Dr. Bedi is a law graduate, master's and a PhD scholar with postdoctoral Nehru Fellowship. She's an author of several books such as I Dare, Always Possible, Creating Leadership, and many more. Dr. Bedi has been voted as the most admired and trusted woman in India by Reader's Digest, The Week magazine, and others over the years. She has a biopic on her life called Yes, Madam Sir, made by an Australian filmmaker, and a recent documentary on her was featured in National Geographic's Mega Icons. She's running two NGOs, which reach out to marginalized sections of society in education, skills development in urban slums and rural areas, including prisons. A keen user of technology, Dr. Bedi has a following around 15 million followers on social networks. Her Twitter handle is @TheKiranBedi, and we are here, you know, receiving this wonderful person and hearing from this wonderful person, the Kiran Bedi herself. Currently, Dr. Kiran Bedi is serving as the Honorable Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry. And it is my honor and privilege to have ma'am on stage with me, talking to an audience of educators across the country and beyond. I think we can say that she is an icon to women, not just in India, but all over the world. The topic that we have chosen for today is learning from the crises and making an education which is a quality education for all. So how to emerge successfully from a crisis and improve education for all. So this here, I would like now hand over at this point the to Dr. Kiran Bedi, and to have her talk a few words about the topic. Thank you so much, ma'am, and I'm so happy and delighted to see you. I should remind, of course, myself that I've had the occasion of being with you in your NGOs in Delhi, and to be driven by you to your NGO and to have that wonderful moment with you in your home. And you're so personable, you're so likable, and for you to show me firsthand your scalable models that you're developing at your two NGOs, which are helping in development, literacy, education for all. And also the collaboration that we have had in the past on Global Dream Literacy campaign, in which children across the country are making people literate, and also the adults are being involved in the process of making people literate. So I'm really so delighted to have you, ma'am, and to revisit with you at this important juncture where we're all puzzled, we're all concerned, what is next awaiting us. So ma'am, over to you, and we look forward to hearing from you. Thank you so much. I'll intervene a little bit later on, and we'll have a little more chat and some more questions from the audience. Audience, please feel free to post your questions in the comment section, and I'll pull those up once in a while. Thank you so much. Ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Sunita. Thank you so much. I want to thank you and your family, you sisters, your parents, for whom I have very, very high respect, because that's when I visited you in 2015. I was very, very impressed from what your family, what you've inherited, but what your parents have done. I saw an amazing enthusiasm, and thereafter, the enthusiasm which the whole family had when you passed it on to my NGOs. And I too was a beneficiary of that. It goes back to 2015. So we go back more than 5 years. And I'm so glad that you connected with me. I instantly remembered, because I was very impressed, and that visit to Lucknow has stayed in my heart and mind. So thank you very much, and appreciate you for organizing this Global Education and Training Institute and the Emerging Stronger from Crisis, a Quality Education for All. Now, look, what brings me to education is because I started my life as an educationist. You'd be not knowing, it's not in a part of my bio data which you did read. Moment I had about 2 months gap between my graduation to my master's class, my first salary came as a Montessori school teacher.
That to Montessori, ma'am, that's pretty remarkable. Wow. Yes, indeed.
And I was very keen to go and teach. I love teaching. So I went hunting for a job. I walked into a school and said, I want to work with children. And I got my first salary from a children's school. So I'm basically a very strong lover of education at heart. Thereafter, the moment I finished my master's, I start to work as a lecturer in political science in Khalsa College for Women, Amritsar. And then, of course, while I was educating, while I was with students, I loved that period of career of mine. I got into the Indian Police Service and went. But I didn't give up on my education because I was very keen, hungry for education. I did my law degree, thanks to my mother, because my mother said, I do not know when you will walk away from the Indian Police Service. Mama, ye useless hai, chhod do. Mere officers, ye senior politicians bahut tang karte hain. So mommy said, you better have a parallel career in your... So my mother made sure I did a law degree. But then she again made sure that I did a PhD. So I've studied and studied. After my doctorate, I went into Nehru Scholarship, which is postdoctoral, which brought books and authorships from me, because Nehru Fellowship compels you, actually expects you, that the third year of your fellowship, you have to publish a book. So I published one of the classics of my prison reform. So I'm basically at heart and a trainer and an educationist. So therefore I fit in very well, beautifully, though I'm into law enforcement and into administration, but I'm basically an educator. And then I went on writing books and regular articles. So therefore I'm very happy to be part of your education movement and will stay with it as long as I can, as long as my faculties are bright and sharp. You've given me a subject and you made me think. And of course, post-COVID is a very new challenge for all of us. Let me share with you, and I know you've got remarkable audience of principals and educationists who are very well experienced. I'm no match for them, but I'll try and do justice to the opportunity you've given me and use it as a privilege to share my views. I'll share with you, my thinking is in three parts, Sunita. One is, I want to define what is education. What do I think is education? Is education a convocation of degrees, examinations, right? Attendance, and scoring and getting gold medals. Yes, that's part of the certification of what we do. But I want to tell you what is education for me. And that's the way it's been as I grew up. For me, it's a constant and sustained learning. That's what I've lived in my life. For me, education was not finishing my master's and graduation and my education is over. For me, it's been constant and sustained learning. And it's also acquisition, but through 2-3 methods. And I want to share with you these three methods, which I have practiced and I believe still. Number one, how do you do constant and sustained learning and acquisition? Number one is through our five senses. The five senses are as I see, as I hear, as I smell, as I taste, and as I touch. These are the five outdoors through which they enter into our 3H. I know you're very excited about what I'm saying. The five in outdoors, these are my absorbers. Now look, why I'm saying this? Because you've not had Rani Jhansi going to a school. You never had Shivaji going to a reformer school. But they are the ones who are considered. You probably didn't even have Chanakya going to school, but you got the Chanakya Niti from him. Which school did they go to? Which university did they go? They created institutions. So what I'm saying is, but they were using all our five senses. So I will tell you why I'm saying this, because this is where we need to go to. This is what education for me is. How do our children absorb and understand the values of these five sensory organs? The see, the hear, the smell, the task, touch, and the taste. Then these five doorways go through 2-3 H, the head, the heart, and the hands. So once all this, what we do, stores here is a memory. And if we keep sharpening it beautifully, it becomes intelligence. Then it goes through a heart, which brings the emotional quotient. And then it brings the hand where we use the skills training. So these five senses for me is education. And then they go through these. This is understanding the value of our system, of our body. What is it that after that we get a degree, but it's a combination of the head, the heart, and the hands. Then two things I want to take you towards, because this is where, because I'm talking to a community of teachers and administrators who have to pass this on to online learning now. And COVID, because of COVID, all this is becoming more and more relevant of what went wrong. All this went wrong because we had abused our senses. We had not looked at our head and our heart and the hands, and we lost out on time and energy. And I'm a very avid listener of Sadhguru. And Sadhguru, all of the Visha Foundation, Sadhguru has been remarked, always been saying, the two things are very important in life is time and energy. If those of us who use our time well evolve, those who are using the energy generated through these H and the five sensories emerge as joyous human beings. But those of us who abuse this time, we let the energy be dissipated, are the ones who are losers in life, but we always are complaining. So this for me is education. Now my next question, which I've thought for you for this event, from what is education? See, I've not talked about masters and degrees, MBAs. For me, this is education. Because once these five sensories are correctly done, the head, the heart, and the hands are correctly placed, and the time is correctly used, and that the energy is correctly generated, tell me what stops me from achieving what I want to achieve. So should I have to tell that ye karo, wo karega, wo bacha karegi, kyunki uski sari cheeze theek hain. अब वो करेगी जिसको उसमें खुशी मिलेगी, तो मुझे उसको कहने की जरूरत नहीं है क्या करो, क्योंकि उसकी चॉइसेस करेक्ट होंगी, वो गलत बात सोचेगी नहीं या सोचे करेगी नहीं, वो टाइम भी नहीं बर्बाद करेगी और एनर्जी भी वेस्ट नहीं करेगी, वो एनर्जी जनरेट करेगी। मेरे चाइल्डहुड में यही हुआ ना, मैंने टाइम वेस्ट किया और अपनी एनर्जी जनरेट की, जिसके साथ मैं यूनिवर्सिटी में भी टॉप करा और मैंने इंडिया नंबर वन भी बनी, क्योंकि मैं पढ़ती थी और खेलती थी और तीसरी चीज का कोई टाइम वेस्ट नहीं होता था, जिसकी वजह से 22 साल की उम्र में मैं इंडियन पुलिस सर्विस ऑफिसर बन गई, क्योंकि मैंने एक भी दिन अपने स्टूडेंट के करियर में वेस्ट नहीं किया, ये आदत बन गई। लेकिन कहां जाता है क्रेडिट? अब मैं जाती हूँ नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन से। व्हेन डज दिस एजुकेशन बिगिन? does this education begin when you enter school? No. The first part of our education is 4 years, from born till 4 years. When does it begin? The beginning is of all these five senses you're born with. You're born with these five senses, but the nurturance of these five senses is in the hands of the home school. And the home school is our parents. You are a product of your parents. You're not self, you initial period of you sisters, you're a product of your parents. I've seen them, how you girls have been nurtured. So first 4 years is totally in the hands of the lap of our parents. Hum wohi khate hain, wohi language bolte hain, wohi kapde pehante hain, wohi humara taste hai. जो हमारे माँ बाप पहले 4 साल देते हैं. तो हमारी होम स्कूलिंग, सो बिफोर एजुकेशन इज बिकमिंग आउटर एंड फॉर्मल, व्हेन वी गो टू अ स्कूल, वी आर ऑलरेडी स्कूल्ड बिफोर वी गो टू अ स्कूल, एंड दैट्स कॉल्ड द होम स्कूल. सो आई वुड से वी, इफ यू हैव टू चेंज द वे वी लुक एट एजुकेशन, वी हैव टू रिवाइंड एंड गो बैक टू द जेनेसिस, बिकॉज बाय द टाइम मेरे टेस्ट बन चुके, मेरी फ्रेंड्स की प्रेफरेंसेस बन गई, मेरे कलर्स. So now up to the age of 4, you are, I've also seen up to the age of 4, children left to nature. Aap brick kiln ke dekhe, mazdooron ke bachche. Bachche wo nange hai bachare, nange ghoom rahe hai. Unko ye bhi nahi pata wo nange hai. Lekin maa bachari, wo dhor rahi hai, bachcha aise hi nanga ghoom raha hai. Uske liye wohi mitti aur patthar. So nurturance ki baat hai. So na hum apna school dhoondte hain us wakat sari cheez aati hai, environment, opportunities and nurturance. Now comes the age of 5 around. Then when we start making our choices. Mujhe baal chote nahi karne, baal bade karne. We've seen little children say, I want a ponytail. Mommy, don't want my, I want my hair like this. The child starts making the choices. So therefore, to me, when now the child goes to school from the age of 4 and 5, the school now takes over and gives the 3 hours in a very versatile way. And then habits are being formed. Cleanly habits. Good morning, madam. Thank you, madam. Or kisi se chori nahi karni. Wo aap unko tayar karo. This to me is education. Ye hai asli education ka aadhar. Aristotle ke paas ek maa bhagi bhagi gayi. Aur Aristotle ko bola, mere bache ko, main kaise isko grow karau? Achha bacha bane. Kehta hai usko, maa ko poochta hai, kitne saal purani beti hai aapki? Bole 5 years. Aristotle said, madam, you are 5 years late. He said, you are 5 years late. So what I'm saying is habits, song, singing, dancing. That's why the schools are so versatile. To bache ko gana, usse pata chalta hai, bache ka hunar kidhar hai, bache ka taste kidhar hai. Bacha koi bolne wala hai, gaane wala hai, drawing karne wala hai, likhne wala hai, writing wala hai, helpful hai. Ye sab cheeze aayengi. So the primary becomes, that is where I would say this is the second part. Now comes the third part of education, is the middle, where the child now is preferring the subjects and is dependent on the teacher. Now the role of the teacher is coming, the way the teacher teaches. If the teachers of maths is very interesting, the child will love maths. If the science teacher is interesting, child will like science. Orientation will go according to the teacher. I loved political science because I had a great teacher. Mrs. Taneja was my teacher in Government College for Women. And I loved honors in English because I had a wonderful teacher. See how I went into humanities. So therefore, now is the role of education as teachers. You see, parents' role remains. Now it becomes plus. And that's where it's a very vital role, how the teacher is addressing the children and reaching out to the middle level. Now, I want to take you to a post-COVID period straight away because you wanted me to do that. Post-COVID period, I feel, has exposed all of our human frailties. All that we did wrong, all these years of humanity, has come right onto our face because we were overdoing, overusing, overexploiting, being all wrongs. They've taught us a lesson and flattened all of us. हम फ्लैटनिंग का मांगते कॉर्निवर्स, अरे हमको फ्लैट कर गया, सबको सीधा कर गया और सबको पूरा, सबको एक लाइन पे लगा दिया, अमीर गरीब की कंट्री का डिस्टेंस दूर कर दिया. अब सब जने अपनी लाइफ के लिए भाग रहे हैं कि मैं जीवित कैसे रहूं, ये नहीं पैसा मेरे पास कितना हो, अब मैं पहले जीवित, पहले लाइव एंड देन लाइवलीहुड. Now we're becoming livelihood in life. Earlier months of entire March, April, May were only on life. Now we are mocking. So I think what the COVID has done is that it has exposed all our human frailties. Now the challenges I believe now are the online has also exposed a big gap between urban and rural divide. Ab pata chala ki urban sara tha, rural to deprived tha. Lekin aaj is COVID ne barabar kar diya. Maine bada सबसे भला फायदा यह कि आज रूरल बच्चा भी अपना फोन लेके जुड़ सकता है और आज गवर्नमेंट चैनल खोलने वाली है कि मेरा चैनल सुनो, लैंग्वेज लो, क्लासेस लो. सी नाउ द गवर्नमेंट्स रोल इन प्रोवाइडिंग टेक्नोलॉजी एंड वेयरविदऑल एंड यू पीपल टू पिच इन गिव द राइट मटेरियल द राइट कंटेंट इट इज नाउ फ्लैटेंड द डिस्टिंक्शन बिटवीन रूरल एंड अर्बन. आई एम नाउ लुकिंग एट इट इन अ पॉजिटिव वे द व्हाइल द कोविड हैज एक्सपोज्ड ऑल आवर ह्यूमन फ्रेलिटीज बट इट हैज आल्सो टोल्ड अस that you better attend to those children whom you were leaving behind economically backward, who could not pay the hefty fees. So therefore, second, it has given us a global platform now at a large scale where you don't need to travel to America or anywhere. It has a scale for you anywhere. Third, online education to be more mainstream by the now the protocols will change. What kind of recruitment, how much technology savvy the teacher is. Now it's the technology which will rule because it has to be delivered by technology. Fourth is that it's learning leading to inclusion in e-learning and transparency in delivery. Nowhere it is a shut door. Everybody can hear. It's a total transparent delivery that how are you teaching? What's your content? So there's a big paradigm shift in our delivery. It's opened up the contents to the entire classroom, and the classroom could be comprising of thousands. The way you're reaching, letting me reach the hundreds of principals, this is what's happening. Today, whatever I'm teaching, I'm being judged by hundreds now. The classroom is open. Nowhere can the class teacher just come and read and go. Teacher has to deliver, otherwise she's out or he's out. Now the opportunity is, mark my words, it's for any time, anywhere, and any one model of higher education. It's now anytime, anywhere, and anyone model of higher education. You have moved to anytime, you can read, I can replay the lecture, I'll have technology, I missed the class, I was working during the day, I'm looking for a lecture, and I get up at night, I can. So it's for anytime, anywhere, anyone is a model of real education. However, the challenge now will be for medical and nursing and engineering, because they need a lot of hands-on. I think that is where the government will now have to work on. How do they mix the medical, the engineering and the nursing? Because that's everything hands-on. So social distancing for some time and masking and sanitation. However, how do they handle medical colleges? How do they handle medical education, nursing education in engineering? So this is what I see. Now I also see a post-COVID development as a cluster of colleges coming in now, cluster of schools coming in, a cluster of universities coming in. We have about 1,000 universities in India. I see a clustering coming in. You can share the content. Now it's coming where I think you can, there's a clustering. People can start joining hands, say, okay, these four universities, these are the USPs of these four, the Harvards and the MITs and the IMMs, etc. We can form clusters where they can say, for this subject I go, and they say, that teacher is the best, that teacher is having the class at this time, I want to go and listen to that. So there would be a clustering now. Okay. You can even hire foreign faculty. You can hire foreign faculty now. And then outbound travel will no more be necessary. You can also now encourage seniors to join in. Seniors like me, who may not have gone to travel, but you can get them on faculty. Senior experiences you can. So I just have 2 minutes more. You have 2 minutes more?
And you have plenty of time.
Okay, good. So I'll not rush through that. So technology.
Take your time.
Thank you. Thank you, Sunita. So I think one of the biggest gain of online education will be your father could be a teacher. You can bring him to the online if he doesn't want to leave home. But you can take the camera through the class and he can give you the Nobel laureates. And many awardees now can become also teachers through online because they couldn't come to the class. The travel cost is very high or travel is difficult. Take the camera to the class. He can be beamed all over. So you can have Nobel laureates, the world watching them. See, the world has become flat now. Flat world has become equal now. So I would say time is now. And I think what is two more things which I share with you is, there is a likelihood in the coming months, coming years, would have no physical campuses. You would have the real world becoming the student or the faculty or learning for students, the real world. Like COVID today is a real world. You can ask the children, what have you learned? This, I learned cooking. I learned from mommy, I learned this. I learned the following habits. I learned a piano or I learned a skill. So, and I learned to be grateful. I learned to be respectful. I learned to be gardening. So this to me, the challenges, I learned to value health. So I would think that now real world will become a classroom for travel. It's like a traveling class. I called it the traveling class. It will become a traveling class with open campuses, no physical boundaries, no walls required, no land to be acquired, no building, no investments, no money. You are an online class. Then I would think you might head for city libraries because you need not have one library. You may have city libraries. You might consider opening up city libraries where children in the open air learning go to a city library and do their homework, and students become a class of their own where they work on a project themselves. Then I would say they might be also common laboratories. So you don't have to come to the school physics lab or a chemistry lab or an IT lab. You go to city labs. Times have changed. You know, I heard these ideas on TED Talks. And they were thinking that all this would come by 2030, 2040. But COVID has made it happen now, 2020. That's why I'm saying time is now. Time is now. You will have laboratories. And you may have venture universities. It was saying in 2050, one of the TED Talks I heard, that venture universities will come in 2050. You can all now are venture universities already. So I would think this is done. But now, one last word. What is it that you can now pass it on to the children? Now to the principals or parents, what should they pass on? Teach your children two things. The COVID lesson, number one, is life is uncertain. Life is uncertain. Enjoy the day. Enjoy the now. Teach them to live in the present. If we can teach them to, COVID's biggest lesson is life is uncertain. And the kind of climate changes we are having and the uncertainty and the disasters coming, kabhi typhoon wahan or hurricane wahan ya cyclone wahan nahi. Now, situation is very, very different. Teach the children the fact and reality of uncertainty. And secondly is, before they think of wealth, they must value health. I think these two, three lessons. And third thing is, be grateful for what you have. I thought these are the things I wanted them, all the children, to learn from COVID. So you're talking to me about education post-COVID. Now, these three things have to be reinforced while teaching the subject, while connecting with the children online, offline, directly, as parents, is life is uncertain. We have no only guarantees today. So do your right thing of the five senses today. Use your time correctly today. Use your energy correctly today. Use your head, heart, and the hands rightly today. When comes tomorrow, it'll be another today. One day at a time, let it be today. And I think I'm grateful for what till went on till yesterday. If we have to educate that these are the lessons from COVID in through education. Now, you see, I've not talked about how do you teach MBA course, how do you teach it. Look, all that follows. When the child's attitude is right, the priorities are right, understanding of realities are right, nothing stops from the child from being a high achiever and earning a wonderful livelihood and living a beautiful life. Thank you, Sunita. Yes, Sunita?
Ma'am, आ गए फाइनली. आई एम सो ग्रेटफुल टू गॉड ऑलमाइटी. द टेक्नोलॉजी हैज शोड अस हाउ वी आर सो वंडरबल व्हेन द टेक्नोलॉजी डज वर्क. यू नो, हियर आई एम इन अ स्टूडियो दैट हैज टॉप नॉच फैसिलिटीज एंड येट द नेटवर्क्स आर सो जिटरी. So I think that you know, here's some one of my first questions then to you is, given our present state of infrastructure, technology, access to technology, access to the net, you know, perhaps we are in a distant dream about making education for all as quickly and readily available online as we would love to do. So what are your views about that? Because obviously there are policy level changes and also policy level directives and enabling environment that we need to see happening. So what are your views on that, ma'am?
Sunita, I'm very, very hopeful because I'm very, very hopeful because the government is not short of money. We had an education stress. Thousands of crores are lying there with the government safe as education stress. You will see them tapping it.
Indeed.
And it'll happen. It'll happen. The money will be available. I'm telling you, this is going to happen before the Prime Minister's tenure is over. I'm not being politically correct. I'm being absolutely sure that the government of the day is right on the top of the situation. They will not lose a single day. And this will get addressed. And you will see amazing. India will rise at the top. India will become the brand master of education. I see this happening. So why should we wait only for the government? You start clustering, start working together, start creating the content, start training programs. Why are you waiting for the government? Did you wait for the government? You brought so many principals together today. Aren't you taking initiative? Start taking initiative. Government will come in, but you must also continue to lead. So every principal, they in their own school and start now, no more competitions. Join hands, time to come together.
I think this is definitely disruptive because so far we've been thinking so much about competition and all domains in which we are excelling in our own ways, but hardly ever there's a platform such as available today for sharing. So this is definitely delightful news for us. But how quickly can we bring about this disruption? You know, how quickly can we act? Because obviously there's an opportunity. If schools open in July, August, whenever they do open, there is a fear that we all go back to the status quo. We are so used to it, we're so familiar with it, that all the learning from the crises will go by the side. So to what extent can we, you know, bring about the revolution in education that is so A, urgently needed, B, that is just so quickly within our reach and we may just miss the boat. So how do we, you know, act in the right way? Or what are those right ways?
Sunita, since I'm in administration, the kind of protocols we are receiving from the government of India, the way the secretaries of government of India and the ministers are every day video conferencing with the chief secretaries and concerned secretaries is amazing. Something's not happened before. The manner, the professional manner in which we're getting these protocols, standing orders, directions, and phasing out, and also regular communication dialogue between the Prime Minister and the Chief Ministers, the Cabinet Secretary and the Chief Secretaries, the Home Secretary and the Secretaries has never been seen before. The manner, the quality of communication has changed. The content of the communication has changed. And priorities now to be at the top has changed. It's evolving. But as I said, while the government does it, so should you people as principals, associations also come together and resolve and strategize and get going.
Right. Ma'am, around the turn of the 20th century, we're talking about 1907, when Dr. Maria Montessori started her Casa di Bambini in a suburb of Rome with just 22 children, and they were the underprivileged children working on the construction site with their parents. And she brought about a worldwide revolution in our thinking about early childhood education and education overall. And I kind of feel, as what you've been saying, is that we are probably at the turn of this 21st century, very much ready to, well, turn of the 21st century, now we are 2020, so it's really already 20 years hence. And we would have thought in 2000, we were looking forward to so many revolutionary changes, and 20 years have just gone by. So nevertheless, as you know, COVID would have it, it has you know, it has definitely created a revolution in our thinking and in our ways of envisioning the future. We are all engaged in it definitely in a different way. And we are seeing a lot of synergies. We are seeing a lot of collaborative possibilities. We are seeing that one teacher, a good teacher, you know, can give a presentation and then that can be heard by millions of children across the country. So quality education can be enabled. And by doing so, that she would also, he would also train a local teacher to become as outstanding, because the potential is there, but the opportunity was lacking. So now with technology, it can be done. The technology hassles, the roadblocks in implementing technology, you're saying, okay, the government is ready. And you're also saying that the government is having those critical discussions that perhaps never took place in the historical past. And for whatever reasons, we are finding the same with the educators. We've had on our Getty panel, we've had over 200 educators who have come and spoken, which is really remarkable. And every one of the speakers hasn't had an average like of 1500, which means 1500 people have viewed on average a single presentation, when this would take 6 months, a year. And people are just not tuning into this kind of platform. So I think that if somehow we can create that momentum, continue that momentum, we could probably foresee a new renaissance in education in 2020. You've also mentioned, you know, what are the parameters, what are the differences that we will be witnessing in this period. So things like, you know, the personal, the idea of transparency, there's a lot more transparency now, the divide, the urban-rural divide, you know, we're going to be able to fulfill that dream of ours of fixing that. Anytime, anywhere, by anyone education, blended education, which is, you know, both available in the context of a physical setting as well as in the context of classroom like this. The massive open online courses that, you know, obviously were conceptualized a few years ago, but were never a reality, can now be a reality even much more. I mean, of course, many, many people are on that, but they still think traditional teaching is a better way to go. Here it is, you can study anytime, anywhere, anytime, anyone, any age, and go and acquire that expertise in anything they wish to. I see a lot of my staff getting on Udemy and edX and so many other you know, learning platforms and LMSs, and not just creating their own courses, but also learning from other courses. So the upgradation is happening at an unprecedented rate. And so these are things you've pointed out. So there are no walls, there are no you know, barriers anymore. The only thing lacking is the personal touch. So we are moving into the kibbutz, the Israeli kibbutz, where, you know, everybody's collaborating, a cluster of schools, the city library, the open air, you know, learning environments, and so many more. So I am, you know, really feeling that we need to continue with that process and not stop it in its tracks. And for that, what are the measures that can be taken in your view? Because many times we see an opportunity, we go towards it, but we don't go further fast enough, or we don't go as much as possible in that direction, so we leave it in its tracks. And we don't want that happening right now, do we? And so what are the things we can be alerted to so that we don't make this go away and, you know, truly bring about a revolution, a disruption in education that we've been waiting for since the century?
See, the job market will look for different jobs now. So we have to now educate in such a way and prepare our children in such a way that they become relevant for the coming job market, for the new job profiles. That means you will have to constantly be thinking. You know, our other books are very good, but they are outdated already. They're getting outdated. So therefore, a constant new material will have to continue to be evolved, which means we need to be thinking with our children, assessing with our children, making them stakeholders in what we are reconnecting. It's no more of teaching. It's all about learning. In fact, teachers themselves have to become learners. Now teachers have to become learners. And learners will need to be guided and mentored. So if teachers are not learners, how will you guide and mentor? They will walk away, because they'll find you irrelevant. So teachers now have to stay relevant, have to become students themselves. And also collaborate. Don't compete anymore. Now collaborate, pitch in. And it should be cluster teaching. The best teacher, the best subject, the best presenter, the best content, It should be now the best children now deserve the best.
And that would work. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead. Finish your thought.
That will only come by your conclaves, your principal conclaves, head girls conclaves, head boy conclaves. Listen to the head boys and head girls. Now, you don't have them only for ceremonial reasons. Listen to the head boys. Arrange, and you teachers should listen to them. You teachers and principals, listen to them. Let them run this conclave. You need to give them the space and the voice, because you're working for their future, not yours. Yours is done. Yours is present. You are builder now. So while your students listening to them will tell you, will keep you relevant. And now it's a partnership. It's not a one-way traffic. So listen to, hold your own conclaves, listen to your head boys and head girls, and then continue to evolve and look at the market and work, and also engage with the market. And you must engage with parents. So you have to work on many fronts. Engaging with parents at home, elders, the expertise, you might have to identify every child, what kind of expertise the child has at home. Why isn't the child, it's like ghar ki murgi dal barabar nahi hai. Arey, meri mummy IT mein PhD hai, toh toh usse kyun nahi seekhti pehle? So I think we need to put back ghar ki murgi dal barabar nahi hai. Meri mummy best hai. I must learn from my father or my mother first. So I think the whole dynamics is changing. So you need to start looking afresh at many, many things. Tap out all the resources which are all spread out and start channelizing them.
Success and crises. You know, you must have, as a very successful person, you must have gone through a lot of crises along the way. What are one or two of the most memorable crises you went through and which led to opportunity for change? And how did you mold it and get out of it and make it a breakthrough for yourself and for society?
Having been a tennis player, I challenged myself every day as a child. I didn't win every match. I didn't lose every match. But being in the sports compelled me to travel long distances and challenge myself with bigger, better players. I lost only to win next time, right? So I think the point here is, for me, life was every day seeking a challenge. So when I get something which doesn't go along with me, for me, it's a focus on where's the answer. And not that get bogged down with it. Where's the answer? That's what I'm saying. That's the training which we have to give to our own children. Now, is to seek an answer. Uncertain life is going to be uncertain. So has it been with me. Many things were uncertain. But that doesn't mean I run away and I be afraid. Look the fear into the eye and find out what are your capabilities to deal with it. Now, these are the skills we need to now train them by hands-on learning, the head, the heart, and the hands. How do we make them combine and value their senses? This is the grooming now which is required from teachers and parents, but the teachers have to also unlearn to learn.
So it is the learn, relearn, unlearn. In fact, unlearn, then learn and relearn, or relearn and then learn. So yes, I think that is definitely a message for all of us, that we as principals, directors, founders of schools, policymakers, teachers, that we need to all appreciate the fact that education is a very, very complex issue. And there are no easy answers. You know, we are talking about psychology of the child, and maybe in this time of crises, the psychology has been affected both positively and negatively. And we need to look at that. We need to look at the human dimension. We need to, you know, look at the example of the teacher, as you have pointed out, the values that the teacher brings to the workplace. We need to nurture those essential things that begin from the home, the homeschooling, and then into the schooling. And so, yes, indeed, learning time is there, but are we going to be able to lap up the learning? Is it going to be available more easily, more less expensive training, so that it can reach everyone and everywhere? What are your thoughts about training of teachers? This is something that we have begun to do over the last year or so, and we're trying to engage the entire education community in training, because we see that that training is where the practice will change. And when practice changes, then we change education. So educators are the rubber that hits the road. They are the ones who are the first contact for the child when they come to school. We don't know what happens behind the doors of a classroom. The teacher knows. And the teacher is empowered if the teacher feels her role is not just, you know, in terms of a job, that she, it's an avocation. It is something that she loves doing because she's the maker of the future. And she sees her responsibility in a vastly different way. I think the teacher will rise up to a different challenge. These are the teachers that will become ideals. They will become the Gurukul teachers that children will worship. They'll write their entire lifelong earnings to them and worship them. These are the kinds of teachers we need. And how do we create those teachers? And how do we make this learning possible that leads to not just learning in the sense of knowledge, but learning in the sense of responsibility, service to humanity, and the great station of a teacher?
When did we think that training is part-time or learning is part-time? The whole life is training, self-learning and training. Why should we think that training is something outsourced and I have to go for a week? I think every minute is a learning exercise. Each one of us, nobody knows better than oneself. What are my strengths and what are my weaknesses? Know thyself. Knowing thyself, why don't I do self-learning? Why can't I do self-learning myself as a teacher if I'm short, if I do not know a particular subject well? Nothing stops me from seeking out help from the online itself or the books. So isn't it my job to self-learn? If I'm a teacher, that means I know how to teach. First, teach yourself. Why are we waiting for 1 week of training? I think every day is a learning. Listening to children, what's happening around the world, what's happening to me and around, I think it's an area for learning. So why are we saying 1 week? If there's a skill you need specially and you're not able to get that, enroll for that. I think teaching should become training.
Sorry, please complete your sentence.
I say, Sunita, I don't think we should encourage to say ki about training ke liye. Nahin, apne aap karo training. Self-learning karo. Books padh ke aao. स्किल सीख के आओ और फिर फाइन ट्यूनिंग के लिए टेस्ट करने आओ, अपग्रेड करने आओ. सो बेसिक्स यू शुड हैव डन, यू शुड हैव रीच्ड एज अ टीचर, रीच द अल्टीमेट दैट आई हैव डन माय रिसर्च, आई हैव एग्जॉस्टेड ऑल द चैनल्स, आई नाउ नीड दैट एक्स्ट्रा बिट, गो फॉर दैट एंड नॉट एलिमेंट्री.
Right, ma'am. So we see that a lot of the principals are open to that idea and they are encouraging the teachers to you know, create learning and to go for learning. While vast majority of the education scene right now has been that we are focused on the syllabus, completion of syllabus. And there's no real motivation or time available for the teacher. She doesn't perceive the need for learning. You know, it's almost like, you know, as my friend Dwight Allen, he, you know, is the emeritus professor in the U.S., who wrote this whole scheme of micro-teaching. And we study that in BEd courses. And he said that after 20 years of teaching, the teachers have the equivalent of 1 year of learning teaching experience repeated over 20 years, not 20 years of real experience. So how do we, you know, how do we create the incentives, the inspiration, the motivation, the spaces within the education system so that the teachers will learn? So I guess a lot of onus depends on the principal, the managers to create their space. But what are their incentives in doing so when the parents are shouting, where's the syllabus and the completion of the syllabus? So where is the time, where is the space in the education system for the critical change to happen, for teachers to become learners and want to learn?
Sunita, let me read out some what Emerson said. He said, we are students of words. We are shut up in schools and colleges and recitation rooms for 10 or 15 years and come out at last with a bag of wind, a memory of words, and do not know a thing.
Voila. Right. And he said it so many years ago.
And it's happening in many places. I don't think we need to teach. We need to encourage self-learning, even among students. Give them the advanced subject of the day. Bachcho, kal hum padhenge aur iske bare discuss karenge. Padho aur phir padhao. और हम डिस्कस करेंगे. तो वन वे लर्निंग क्यों करते हो? देन ओपन इट अप एज अ प्रोजेक्ट, ओपन इट अप एज अ डिस्कशन. तो क्यों नहीं हम लोग रादर देन टीचिंग गेट इनटू सेल्फ लर्निंग एंड म्यूचुअल लर्निंग एंड कोलैबोरेटिव लर्निंग एंड एक्सप्रेस्ड लर्निंग एंड डिस्कस्ड लर्निंग एंड क्रिटिकल लर्निंग एंड देन आस्क देम व्हाट हैव यू लर्नड फ्रॉम दिस. सो दैट मींस यू आर इन क्रिटिकल लर्निंग.
Critical learning, right? So I have an idea, you know, because there is no incentive in schools for the teachers to learn, and there's no room or there's no space in the schedule for the teachers to learn. So one lesson would be perhaps that the managers, the principals, they create a Saturday every week for learning. Now some schools are doing it, but not across the country, and maybe not across the world either. And the other thing is that we can save a lot of time. So if you have, you know, a cluster of schools, or you have your own teachers in many sections, that they can perhaps teach some of the time in online way, in which case all the children can be recipients of learning, and you save a lot of time, in which then training can be enabled. So to create that space for learning and the incentive and motivation for learning, we have to think on that issue as well, and that could be one way. You might have some other thoughts on that as well, because clearly we are dealing with a crisis of mindset. You know, we are talking about a fixed mindset about learning, you know, like Carol Dweck's
COVID. Anita, if COVID is not going to change that mindset, we can't have another one. Another COVID means none of us will be here.
Right.
This is not going to take us out of the slumber, then we will not be surviving for one more. I think it's stage for everyday learning, a daily. Look, good lawyers, who are the good lawyers who get up early in the morning and do self-study and refer to the books and go to the judgments and prepare? Why? Because that case has to be won every day before the Honorable Supreme Court. Why not the same with the teachers? Why can't they get up early again or whenever is do self-learning, self-preparation, so that they can deliver inspiration, not subject, inspiration, knowledge, critical thinking, attitudinal change to the students. Why not? Is that because that one day, because you have to win the case or you have to earn a lot of money, here you got a fixed salary whether you teach or not, doesn't matter? Not like that. If COVID is not going to change, look, we have hundreds and thousands of lives in our hands. This world now needs a new generation. This world needs a new humanity, a new way of thinking. So unless the teacher changes, how will the change impact? How will you pass on the change? You, as a teacher, you got to change so that you drive the change to every child. Every child has to be now. Every child makes a difference. And there's a theory by a French mathematician called Edward Lippers, I forget his name. And he has called the butterfly theory. Butterfly theory is, he said, the theory is a very popular theory, and this is what exactly COVID has happened. Let me explain to you the butterfly theory. Butterfly theory is where the MIT mathematician said, Edward somebody, you can said that a butterfly's one wing caught off in Texas has a ripple effect somewhere else in Buenos Aires or somewhere else. How? What has happened here in COVID? Tell me what has happened in COVID. In February, President of America knew something's gone wrong. He let it go. That's the time to catch it. The China was cautioned in time by one person, and one family that there is a contact tracing. This is infectious. One person in America alerted his president. One person alerted the government of China. One person, and today millions have died or millions have got affected. One person, it started from one person, whether it was the wet market or whether it was a laboratory, we do not know yet, but it started from one person. That's a butterfly effect theory by this MIT a mathematician. It starts with, why am I talking butterfly? It's every child. A stitch in time saves nine. Every child is a stitch which saves nine of his lives, all through nine challenges of his life. So today we have to look at every life. So the teacher has to now look at every child as a life, not as a student, as a life. So the moment we start, if COVID doesn't teach us this, then I think we will not survive for one more.
So Kofi Annan, in his address at the turn of the century in 2000, he said that the 20th century had been the most brutal and murderous in human history. Now is a chance also, we've seen some very good petitions going on by the UN Secretary General, is a chance to to end all crises as well. Having been an IPS officer, besides being a tremendous educator, what are your views on this particular issue of bringing a more humanitarian world to bear into the future?
That lies in the hands of parents and teachers. Parents for the first 4 years and thereafter, plus teachers. It is we are connecting to every child and we are making the life of every child. After that, what happens? We have to make the child help make better choices. Groom them to make their own choices also, not imposed choices, but better choices by voluntary vessel. I think once we do that, we are creating a better humanity. And it starts from every home. Every home makes a neighborhood. Every neighborhood makes a village. Every village makes a community. And every community makes a state. And the states coming make a nation. And nations make the world. Every classroom makes a school. So we have to work on stitch and time saving nine. Now every teacher must look at every child as a life. And every teacher must look at themselves also as a life. So I think we need to look at now differently. Humanity is in our hands. First of all, parents must stop giving birth to children for whom they don't have the capability. They must deliver a child if they have the capability and the love for it. Otherwise, forget it. Why? There's no such binding. There's no mandate that you have to, because every child matters. Every child comes and changes and transforms the world. So I think every woman should now take a vow that I will give birth to a child if I have the capability and the love for the child. Otherwise, it's okay, adopt another child. Support another child, they're enough. I think we need to take as women very conscious decisions. As parents, of course, father has a wonderful responsibility too. Even they have to take a responsibility that if I cannot invest into my child, then I have no business and not go on multiplying. Because every child matters.
Yes, indeed. That's another problem we can probably tackle through education. So what I think, ma'am, we can bring this to a close. It's almost over an hour. And I just want to say that what you've been talking about is that the future is within the schools, within the four walls of a school lies the future. And to the extent that we as educators understand our responsibility, we understand that we can disrupt education, we can do something vastly different with a given God-given opportunity in the form of a crisis. We can emerge stronger from the crisis. We can learn from the pages of your presentation today, from the deep insights that you've been giving us on how we can, you know, henceforth lay out the foundation of a new education. Because when the foundation is strong, the building will be also. So what is that foundation? You've made it very, very clear for us that it is a foundation of perhaps what we might call the four building blocks from your presentation. One is universal values, that the values agenda must be from the home to the school, everywhere, teachers and role models. And we can't forget that in a humanitarian world to make it possible. Global understanding, that we are part of one human family, right? And that we not just teach our children coexistence, but we also teach them cooperation and love in the heart for each other, regardless of race, color, creed, and any kind of differences, black or white. We see that whenever there's injustice, like in Mahabharata, you know, there is a crisis that's created. So crisis of ourselves reflected in COVID, crisis on the streets that we see in so many countries, and right now in the United States of America. It's all because of injustice. So that global understanding that we're part of one human family, the one part of our body, when it's afflicted, the whole body hurts. We feel the pain everywhere. And the third building block that you have talked about is excellence, in all things, starting with teachers as learners, principals as learners, educators as learners, leaders as learners, and those opportunities, new opportunities have been created through the crises. In that excellence in all things, you have pointed out that it's time for collaboration, not for competition. And if we do so, then we are going to create a new paradigm shift in education. And we can probably bring out more excellence in everyone also, because we'll not be comparing children either. We won't be comparing ourselves. Our focus will shift from teaching to learning and to excellence in all things. So by learning, we become excellent, and over time, we'll become super excellent. So that is something that is the third building block from what you've said. And the fourth building block that I see is something that you have been doing through your NGOs, Navjyoti Foundation and India Vision Foundation, that is service to humanity. That every child should emerge as a servant of humanity, that they should be, and we as teachers are in any case involved in a field that can be called a field of service. So if we can do these four aspects, universal values, global understanding, excellence in all things, and service to humanity, that we will have a new foundation of a new building of education. And in that building, we will all feel safer compared to the old building that's crumbling down. And that will invariably crumble down, because no matter what we do, whether we keep putting more cement in the building and fixing the windows, but this building is falling down. The old has to give way to the new. And this is perhaps what you're saying, we can learn from the crises. So I really, really appreciate all that you have shared with us. There's so many deep insights and so many lessons for us educators. And you, as a great educator, as someone who has led by not just head, but by heart, by example, by being, you know, somebody who is in the front lines of change, I think we have a lot that we can follow from this presentation. I hope every educator across the country and beyond will listen to Dr. Kiran Bedi's presentation. And I'm so ever so grateful to you to join our disruptive education movement with Global Education and Training Institute. And really, thank you with my whole heart. Thank you so much.
I'm going to give you a takeaway. I give you a takeaway for teachers? A takeaway?
Absolutely.
Let the teachers be like gardeners. Let the teachers be like gardeners. And pass on this message to the children of the law of sowing and reaping. Let the children be known that if you plant honestly, if you plant honesty, you will reap trust. If you plant goodness, children, you will reap friends. If you plant humility, you will reap greatness. If you plant perseverance, you will reap victory. If you plant consideration, you will reap harmony. If you sow hard work, you will reap success. If you sow forgiveness, you will get reconciliation. If you sow openness, you will reap intimacy. If you sow patience, you will see improvements. And if you sow faith, you will reap miracles.
Awesome. Thank you, ma'am, for disrupting education and our thinking. Thank you ever so much. Really appreciate those last words and loving words from you, and very insightful words from you. Thank you so very much for your time.
Sunita, you and your father and your mother and your family, and your institutions, and all the principals who've heard me, and all your participants who've given me so much of respect and regard. I've seen some of the comments. I could mention a few names, I couldn't mention others, but I value every bit of their contribution. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's been a great learning exercise even to be on web here today. For me, also, these are innovations. Thank you.
Thank you for making education a hot subject. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Namaste. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for being with us.